Here we consider mainly Descartes' cogito principle and causal argument for the existence of God to demonstrate the application of Cartesian method in metaphysics. So, the most important thing is to understand the implications of the famous Cartesian dictum, cogito ergo sum. As we have shown, it means by translation into English, we can see that it means, some people say it translates it as I think therefore I exist, but most precise translation is I am thinking, I am thinking therefore I exist. Now, this cogito principle becomes the axiom of all human reasoning according to Descartes. Now, we shall analyze how he proves it. How do we understand the proposition I am thinking? My question is, how do we understand the proposition? By what means we grasp the proposition I am thinking? Sure, not by sense experience. There is no need of any medium other than thinking to grasp the judgment, and hence it is immediate and self-evident truth. You just consider a person thinking that I am thinking. Nobody can dispute it. It is as true as the mathematical proposition 2 plus 2 is equal to 4. So, Descartes proves how the metaphysical axiom of cogito ergo sum is logically equivalent to the mathematical propositions like 2 plus 2 is equal to 4. In Descartes' own words, he says, cogito ergo sum is the first and most certain knowledge that occurs to one who philosophizes in an orderly manner. Like the axiom of cogito, the core of Descartes' proofs for the existence of God is another intuitive judgment, namely the principle of causality, which we consider as a law of nature, which we understand by intuition. According to Descartes, one of the innate ideas in human mind is that of God. It needs no further proof because we know intuitively that nothing can come out of nothing. This is called the principle of causation or the law of causality. Descartes argues that my existence as a thinking being is self-evident, which he had already proved by the cogito principle. And I cannot come into existence without a cause that precedes my existence according to the law of causation. God is therefore that eternal and perfect being of all beings, including myself. Descartes argued that such a perfect being must be self-caused. It cannot have another thing as its cause, that is, God is self-caused, uncaused. Because if it is not the case, suppose God has a cause, logically, we have to admit an infinite regress in conceiving causality. So, if we argue that I have a cause and that cause is God, and therefore God has a cause, you have to search for God as the cause of me, then you have to search for the cause of God, and further the cause of God, it goes on infinitely, which is a logical fallacy called the infinite regress. In order to avoid this infinite regress, Descartes argued that God is intuited, and that intuition of God is the intuition of a self-caused being of all beings. And this causal argument for the existence of God is based on the axiom of causality, according to which nothing is uncaused or everything is caused. And Cartesian method is even today recognized as valuable and fruitful in our search for truth in any area of study. For example, his emphasis on clarity and certainty of knowledge as the benchmark of truth remains the ideal for scientists and philosophers alike. In all the areas of knowledge we consider, truth depends upon, or truth is can be communicated only if the expression of knowledge is clear and distinct and certain. So it remains the ideal, epistemological ideal for all scientists and philosophers even today. Another important feature of Cartesian method is his rejection of authority as the standard of truth. Certainly, it is the motivation to doubt any piece of knowledge until it is proved on the basis of the axioms of truth. For example, in physical sciences, we consider the laws of nature as axiomatic, and we have already stated that mathematical propositions are the model for axiomatic truth. Anyway, critics of Cartesian method have questioned the validity of applying mathematical method to all other disciplines. Many critics argue that philosophy is not a mathematical discipline, hence it is not proper to apply mathematical method to a discipline like philosophy. And we have seen that Descartes had begun his philosophical inquiry from the intuitive certainty of cogito, which is not at all doubted. But Descartes, like any other rationalist idealist thinker, could not establish the existence of pure thinking without reference to objective reality. A thinking mind is always in a body, and a body is always in a world. So we cannot actually recognize some piece of thinking or knowledge as pure or free from empirical considerations. Anyway, in spite of all these objections and criticisms, Descartes certainly remains one of the great methodologists in the rank of Socrates and Aristotle.